We will come to order now. First of all, I would like to say good morning to everybody. Today is November the 1st, 2020, Bible study guide number 9. Today's title, Loving by Serving. The background scripture comes from John chapter 13, verses 1 through 35. The printed text is John chapter 13, verses 1 through 15. In verses 34 and 35. Our devotional reading will come from John chapter 15, verses 18 through chapter 16, verse 4. At this time, I would like for everyone to join me in a verse of song. Pass me not, O gentle Savior. Hear my humble cry. Why on others thou art calling? Do not pass me by. I'm calling you, Savior, oh, Savior. Hear my humble cry. Why on others thou art calling? Do not pass me by.
This morning, reading to you from John chapter 15, verses 18 through John chapter 16, verses 4. If the world hate you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world will love his own. But because you are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you. Remember the word that I say unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord. If they have persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they have kept me saying, they will keep yours also. But all these things will they do unto you for my name's sake, because they know not him that sent me. If I had not come and spoken to them, they had not had sin. But now they have no cloak for their sin. He that hates me hates my Father also. If I had not done among, they have not done among them the work which none other man did, they did not have sin. But now have they both sinned and hated both me and my Father. But it's come to pass that the word might be fulfilled that is written in their law, they hate me without a cause. But when the Comforter is come, whom I will send to you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceed from the Father, he shall testify of me. And ye have also bear witness, because you have been with me from the beginning. These things I have spoken to you, that you should not be offended. They shall put you on out of these synagogues, ye. The time cometh that whosoever killeth you will think that he doeth God's servants. And these things will they do unto you, because they have not known the Father nor me. But these things I have told you, that when the time shall come, ye may remember that I have told you of them. And these things I said unto you at the beginning, because I am with you. I read from John chapter 15, verses 18, verses chapter 16, verse 4.
Thank you. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, creator of heaven and earth, Father, we thank you this morning for just waking us up this morning. We thank you, Father, for touching us with that finger of love, thanking you for our health and our strength. First of all, Father, we want to thank you for your darling son, Jesus, that died on the cross for all our sins. We thank you, Father, for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. Father God, we pray that you touch some of our members this morning to come out and hear a word from you, Father. Our doors are open, and I pray that they come out and hear this word. I pray that you touch our members this morning, everybody that go out and vote, so we can try to get us a new person to lead this country. We pray for our sick and our shut-in. We pray for our bereaved family. We pray that you bless our servant this morning from the Sunday school throughout the morning service. Bless the pastor as he brings the word. Bless everyone that's bowed with me in prayer. These blessings we ask in your darling son, Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I shall not be moved. I shall not be moved, just like a tree that's standing by the water. I shall not be moved. I'm on my way to heaven. I shall not be moved. I'm on my way to heaven. I shall not be moved, just like a tree that's planted by the water. I shall not be moved.
I would like to thank everyone for joining us in our opening this morning. And at this time, we will turn it over to Rem Conner for our Sunday school lesson.
Good morning, everyone. morning. Truly indeed, it's a blessing to be in the Lord's house one more time. Have a wonderful Sunday school lesson in store this morning. But before we get into our lesson this morning, just like to extend prayer out for those that are sick, those that are shut in, praying for our family members, and just keep those lifted up in our communities and in our nation as we go through these trying times that we're dealing with in the political realm. But truly indeed, regardless of what goes on politically, we know that God is able and that we know the God that we serve. And in knowing that, we know that we shall be taken care of, and we know that our Lord and Savior will provide for us, and that we don't need to be dependent upon our government. As long as we're depending on the Lord shall and will make a way. I also like to keep those lifted up that have lost their loved ones upon this past week. Let us continually pray for them, that our God and our Lord and Savior would give them comfort during these trying times. Received a message from my auntie this morning, my auntie Sylvia Lewis down in Florida. They pastor unexpectedly passed, Pastor Yates, I believe. I can't remember the name of the church, but let us definitely keep that congregation lifted up in prayer. It is truly indeed something to deal with when you have lost your spiritual leader. So we need to keep that congregation lifted up in prayer, that they may rest and abide in the Lord and see them through this time. So let us keep them lifted up in prayer. And also keep anyone else that have lost any of their loved ones, anyone that is dear to their hearts, just keep them lifted up in prayer that our Lord and Savior will guide them through this. But this morning, our lesson this morning is coming from John chapter 13, verses 1 through 15, and then 34 through 35. And our lesson title this morning is Loving by Serving. Loving by Serving. I misdid my title on my thing, said Love by Serving, but it's Loving by Serving. Loving by Serving. And this morning I want to read our In Focus story. It's very interesting, and it's something we probably see in many of our churches. It says, Pastor John Ricks was given last-minute instructions to the courtesy committee. We are to serve over 100 guests from Bless Hope Church. They will be coming here from Boston next week to fellowship with us, and we want to be sure they are treated kindly, said the pastor. So after the meeting, and I'm sure many of you have witnessed this, those after-meeting conversations, it says Joanne and her friend Barbara walked to their respective cars. Barbara was the first to speak, said, I'm not serving anyone. Every time a church comes here, we are always the ones called on to serve. Isn't there anyone else in this church who can work? Barbara, you shouldn't be that way. After all, we're the courtesy committee. It's our job to serve others, to serve wherever we are needed and help in whatever area we can, said Joanne. Yeah, but I'm not a servant, said Barbara. I didn't come to this church to work like a slave, and I just came to worship the Lord. And so the question is asked here, if Jesus didn't mind humbling himself and being obedient to the Father, shouldn't we have the same attitude? So this week we will see how Jesus, Son of God, decided to show his disciples the mark of a true servant by washing what? Their feet. And so I know many of you probably laugh at that, but it's something how we do have many church members that they have that same perspective attitude. They have that same attitude, you know, that they don't want to serve people. Or they have such a nasty attitude when it comes to serving others. And that's not, you know, the saying goes, that's not Christ-like. We are servants. We are servants one to another. And that is what we're going to see out of this lesson this morning, loving by serving. Loving by serving. And so, if we look at our background this morning, It says, wearing open sandals on dusty roads made it necessary to wash one's feet frequently. Therefore, a host would customarily provide water for his guests upon their arrival, and so that they may wash their feet. But now, sometimes, a servant performed his service for the guests. So as recorded in John's Gospel, the act of foot washing was a twofold significance. First, it is symbolic prophecy of Jesus' atoning death, which would cleanse from sin and make it possible for his disciples to inherit eternal life with him. Now, secondly, it is a lesson in humility. Some have also seen the foot washing as alluding to the sacraments of baptism and the Lord's Supper, but Luke informs us that the disciples were having a heated conversation, discussion earlier, prior to the Passover meal. Now, the Gospel of John does not record this heated discussion, but John does record for us the powerful, dramatic response on the behalf of Jesus, which was the master teacher. So, because he is going to be away for a long time, Jesus gathers his disciples this night to give them instructions on how to live with one another until he returns. So Jesus encourages and instructs them regarding how to live as children of God in what? In a world full of evil. So look around at our world today. Jesus gave his disciples instructions then on how to love one another and how to live in a world full of evil. He talks to them about serving one another and living in love and what? Harmony. So love is a trademark of all believers. So through love for one another, the world will know that what? We are his who? Disciples. Through love for one another, the world would know that we are Jesus' disciples. You got to check yourself on that one, don't we? Through love. Love is a trademark of all believers. So it goes back to our In Focus story, you know, the lady not wanting to serve. You know, she just wanted to come to church to do what? To worship. How can you come to church to worship if you don't want to take on the fullness of Jesus Christ? It's kind of hypocritical, isn't it? See, if we say we come to church to worship, that means we're taking in the Word of God. And if we're taking in the Word of God, it means what? We need to take on the attributes of Jesus Christ. And if we take on the attributes of Jesus Christ, it means what? Love is a trademark of all believers. See, it is something how in this society we live in today that we see this constant display of hatred towards blacks. We see this constant display of hatred towards whites, towards Mexicans, towards anyone of another descent that is not of our color or our race or our ethnic group, whatever you want to say. So we see this constant display of these things going on. But here's the thing that I have to say on that. If we say that we are children of God, if we say we are children of God, search your scripture. When you look at Jesus' teachings, where did he classify Jews, Gentiles, bond, free, slave, non-slaves? Where did he classify that there was to be a division between us? There's no division. Love is love one another. He did not say love those of your race, love those of your same color. That is not what he said. He said what? Love your neighbor. Your neighbor might not look like you. Your neighbor's not gonna act like you. Your neighbor could be different from you, but Jesus said love your neighbor. So we are to love our neighbor. If we are to love one another, that washes out all of this racist attitude. That wipes that out. We're supposed to love one another. And that is what Jesus is showing us here. And we will see here this morning in this lesson, not only to love one another, but look at what he does to his enemy. And I know many are going to get in an uproar over that one. But I have to ask you this question here going off of that. Would you wash your enemy's feet? Would you wash your enemy's feet? And why or why not? Would you wash your enemy's feet? I'm talking about somebody you don't like, somebody you can't stand, somebody you just, Lord forgive you, you just hate them. Would you wash their feet? Knowing their intent, knowing how they feel about you, would you wash their feet? See, why or why not? Would you do it? Would you do it? Now let me help you out on this. Jesus displays servanthood. Our first lesson, our first part is Jesus displays servanthood. John 13, verse 1 through 5, it says, "Now before the feast of Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour was come, that he would depart out of this world unto the Father, having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them unto the end. And supper being ended, the devil having now put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him. Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he was come from God and went to God, he rises from supper and laid aside his garments and took a towel and girded himself. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel wherewith he was," what? "Girded." Jesus displays servanthood. Would you wash your enemy's feet? Although he walked on earth as a human, Jesus did what? He maintained his divine nature. He was totally aware of all things, including the purpose of his coming to earth and precisely the time of his departure. So this separated him from ordinary humans. Now, verse 3 also explained the fact of Jesus Christ's divinity. Jesus knowing refers to his being aware, having the knowledge or being conscious that the Father had given all things into his hands. It seems that his knowledge of both coming of the coming moment of his departure and his divine authority and glory were basic to his teaching. So the foot washing was also triggered by the disciples' argument about who would be the greatest among them. And see, you still see things like that going on in the church. Who's the greatest? You know, well, you know, I'm the head of the usher committee, you know, so I'm the greatest. I'm the head of the hospitality committee, I'm the greatest. Well, I'm the associate, I'm the greatest. Well, I'm the reverend, I'm the greatest. I'm the president of such and such, I'm the greatest. You always see this going on. And then some people ain't even got a title. They just come in thinking they dress better than everybody else, so they the greatest. So you see all this stuff going on in the church about who's the greatest, who's this, who's that, who has more authority, who has more influence. You always see all this stuff going on. But see, look at how Jesus lays the plan field down. They are also absorbed in their conversation. They so absorbed in their conversation, their disagreement, that nobody even notices what Jesus is doing. Now, interestingly, we know that this is Jesus' final meal before he goes to the cross. Yet he is not absorbed in his own thoughts as they are. Jesus Christ is about to go to the cross and be crucified. He knows this. They sit here arguing about who's the greatest among them, and they all walking with Jesus. And they all absorbed in this. But here's our Savior knowing that he's going to the cross, and he's not even absorbed in all his thoughts. He sees a need, though, to demonstrate an important lesson, and he moves to prepare the items that he needs. Now, apart from the real teaching of this event of humility and servitude, Jesus is also following a Jewish custom. And however, to the Greeks and Romans, the washing of feet was the duty of what? The lowest slave. It is in this context of servitude that Jesus presents this teaching. And Jesus served not only the faithful disciples, but get this, but Jesus also served his enemy. Judas' feet were washed along with all the rest. And Jesus knew that Judas was going to betray him. So we see Jesus following a custom here. And seeing this custom was, you have to understand that when you was at dinner back then, the tables that they had was about the height of what we call a coffee table today. So they were low tables. And so they sat on the floor on pillows. And so it was customary, you know, you couldn't enjoy dinner with dirty feet, you know, because you sitting low, feet crossed. I mean, your feet are right there. So you had to have clean feet. And so this is why it was customary for them to wash their feet. And so you having dinner here, so Jesus prepares everything. He prepares everything, and he goes around and starts washing their feet, which this was the duty of the lowest slave, to wash the guest's feet. Now understand this. Jesus was called master teacher. Jesus was called Lord. Jesus was esteemed to be, as we would say, high on a totem pole. But now here is Jesus in his position, bound down to this lowly position, doing what? Washing feet. How many of us would bow down from our so-called high positions to wash somebody's feet? And not only that, question, would you allow a person in leadership to serve you when it's your responsibility? If this is your job and your duty to do, would you allow somebody in leadership, the president of whatever, your CEO, your pastor, would you allow somebody in leadership to serve you? You know, or would you be, no, I'm not going to let you do that. You know, that's my job. Because we're going to get to Peter here in a minute. See, it is something when someone in leadership can humble themselves down to a lower status than what they should be on to serve others. And that is what Jesus is showing us here in this lesson about being a servant, regardless of your position, regardless of who that person might be, to be a servant, to serve those that even though they might be your enemy. Jesus says, be a servant. And so we see here in this next session, it says Jesus defines servanthood. So many of you might have a question, well, what's a servant? What's a servant? So Jesus defines servanthood. Look at verse 6 through 11. It says, then cometh he to Simon Peter, and Peter saith unto him, look at Peter now, Lord, dost thou wash my feet? Jesus answered and said unto him, what I do thou knowest not now, but thou shalt know hereafter. Peter saith unto him, thou shalt never wash my feet. And Jesus answered him, if I wash thee not, thou hast what? No part with me. Simon Peter saith unto him, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. So Jesus saith unto him, he that is washed needeth not save to wash his feet, but is clean every whit, and ye are clean, but not all. For he knew who should betray him, therefore he said, ye are not all what? Clean. Jesus defines servanthood. Now let's look at this. Peter understands the lowliness of this act so well that when it is his turn, he refuses to have the Lord wash his feet. Peter emphasizes that he's not worthy for the Lord to wash him. So Peter, ignorant of the spiritual and moral implications of this act, refuses to be washed by Jesus. Now Jesus makes it clear to Peter that there is a motive behind what he is doing and promises to explain it to him. Now still Peter stubbornly refuses to yield to the feet washing. He tells Jesus, thou should never wash my feet. Peter's understanding of this act is only what? Physical. He ain't understanding the spiritual aspects of it. But he later learns that something more than mere washing of the feet is involved here. There's also a spiritual dimension. It is characteristic of the way the disciples could participate in Jesus' humiliation and his suffering. Now, after Jesus explains, Peter goes to the other extreme. Now, look at this. Now, he finally understands the spiritual side. But now, look at what he does. He goes to the other extreme. First, it was, you ain't gonna never wash my feet. So now, he understands the spiritual implications. So now, he goes to the other side, the extreme other side, and says, he asking Jesus to do what? Clean more of him. Now, once again, Jesus patiently replies, he that is washed need not save to wash his feet. So in the spiritual life, a person who has been cleansed from his or her sins through faith in Christ need only what? Now, y'all got to get this. A person who has been cleansed from his or her sins through faith in Christ need only confess those sins to be entirely clean again. Look at 1 John 1 and 9. Jesus takes this opportunity as he talked about cleanliness to point out that not everyone in the room is clean. Jesus wants Judas to know that he is fully aware of Judas' intentions and that this act will mark him as what? Unclean. So here, just hours before his betrayal, was an opportunity for Judas to do what? Repent. But there was no confession or repentance on the part of Judas. And Jesus showed Judas, that he was not going to hinder him with his evil intentions. Now, I want you to back up a minute. The spiritual life. A person who has been cleansed from his or her sins through faith in Christ need only do what? Confess. Now, I hope y'all got this. You only need to confess. Jesus let Judas know that he knew one sitting here was not clean. Jesus washed all their feet. Now, I hope you're getting this. All you got to do is confess your sins to be cleansed from them. Jesus gave Judas the opportunity right here. Upon washing his feet, Judas, I know you're going to betray me, but here's your opportunity, Judas, to repent. Judas didn't repent. Judas sat there. Judas got his feet washed. Judas didn't repent. Here's what I'm getting at here. We can come before Christ to give our lives to him, but there has to be repentance. See, many will come into church and say, you know, Lord, 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 but you ain't repenting. So you got to repent. Judas sat here and didn't repent. So in order for you to be cleansed of your sins, you have to repent. But there was no confession by Judas or repentance on his part. And that is why Jesus said, there's one of you here that's unclean. So even though he had the opportunity to repent, even though Jesus washed his feet to cleanse him of his sins, he still didn't repent. He still didn't confess his sins and repent. So therefore, he was still left what? Unclean. I hope y'all got that. He was still left unclean. His heart didn't change. His intentions didn't change. So it begs me the question, you know, when you look at many in the church, yes, I'm going to go there. You look at many in the church, and you have to wonder. You sitting in there running around shouting, hollering, talking in tongues, doing all this other stuff, you know, acting up and all this. But you still got that same ways that you had when you was in the world and you ain't let them go. It makes me question, have you repented? Because if you have not repented, you still holding on to that. You got to repent. You have to repent and let God work in you and renew your mind, give you a new mind, a new way of talking, a new way of acting. Your ways should change. And that is why I said earlier, when we sit here and we have these racist attitudes, we have this hatred in our hearts, and we say we are representatives of Jesus Christ, I beg to differ. Are you really a representative of Jesus Christ having this hatred in your heart when Jesus tells us we are to love one another? He didn't say love black, love white, love just this certain particular group. He said love one another, love your neighbor. Our neighbor might not necessarily be black or white. And that's just the truth of it, Deacon McKenzie. They could be of a different ethnic group. But we are to love our neighbor. We are to love one another in the body of Christ. We are all different. And so we are to love one another. But I want to ask you this question. Are you a servant? Are you a servant? Be very careful before you answer that. Are you a servant? I'm just not talking about serving your family. I'm not just talking about if you're a member of St. Paul that you only serve members of St. Paul. Are you a servant? Because when you look at what Jesus' definition of a servant was, Jesus said what? Love one another. Serve one another. Jesus was a master. He was a teacher. He was Jesus, the Son of God. And here he is, Deacon McKenzie. He can call on a legion of angels and just handle business. But here Jesus Christ is, Deacon McKenzie. He's down low. He washing feet. He done took off his garment, wrapped his garment around him. He down here washing feet. How many of y'all get on y'all knees, wash somebody's feet? Because see, you think you're too high and mighty. You can't do that. You can't humble yourself down to do that. But this is what Jesus did. So ask yourself the question, are you a servant? Not just a servant to your house, not just a servant to your church, but are you truly in your heart a servant? And that's a servant to who? Anyone. Love one another. Lastly here, Jesus explained servanthood. He explained servanthood. Look what he says in verse 12 and then verse 34 through 35. Verse 12 says, so after he had washed their feet and had taken his garments and was set down again, he said unto them, know ye what I have done to you? Ye call me master and Lord and say, well, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and master, have washed your feet, ye also ought to wash what? One another's feet. For if I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you, a new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. By this shall all men know what? That ye are my disciples, if ye love what? One to another. Jesus explains servanthood, and he tells them here, if I am your Lord, your master, this is the title that you give me that I am. If I can do it, you can do it. So after washing their feet, Jesus proceeds to teach them the application of this servant's service and implications of his actions. He knows how limited their understanding is. His intention is to get their attention and to make them think. So to answer his own question, Jesus appeals to his relationship with them and reminds them that the Lord and servant relationship. Jesus uses his double title as teacher and Lord to strike an important note. The disciples, by inference, know what it means to be teacher or Lord. It does not include what? Washing feet. So they understand for you to be a teacher or Lord, you ain't supposed to be washing no feet. It does not make any sense for a teacher to do what? Stoop down and wash his servant's feet. So with this understanding, Jesus now goes to make his point, which is the climax of the narrative, how to serve one another as disciples and yes, as what? as Christians. So the message is clear. He says, for all y'all that have this hatred in your heart, for all y'all that say you are Christians, but you don't like this ethnic group, you don't like this ethnic group, you out here with all this nonsense going on, let's look at what he says. If I, being your master and Lord, would condescend to do this, you should be willing to do the lowest service for one another. This act is revolutionary since humility. See, humility was despised as weakness back in ancient times. Have you ever heard the term that a man is not supposed to cry because it shows weakness? And see, humility back then was weakness. But being humble and volunteering, placing yourself in a station below your rightful place was unheard of. And Jesus made humility, what, a virtue when it was not before. So they are to serve one another. He tells them that he has set an example for them to follow and calls them to imitate him. For Jesus, love is the central theme that ties all teachings and the foundation of which Christianity is built upon. Love is the central theme, and it ties everything, all his teachings, the foundation on which Christianity is built upon, emphasizing the importance of what? Love. Jesus says that he's giving a new commandment, that is to love one another. So see, he expounded upon the old commandment. He added on to it. And now we are to love one another. See, everything was completed with Jesus Christ. So if you go back into the Old Testament, Deacon McKenzie, you'll see where you had slaves, you had Jews, you had Gentiles, you had Samaritans, you had all these other groups, Deacon McKenzie, that were hated and despised. Jews and fool with them. You know, we too clean. We God's chosen people. We don't fool with y'all. But look at what Jesus comes on the scene and does. We are to love one another. There should be no difference between bond, between free, between Jews, between Gentiles, between slaves, non-slaves. There should be no difference. And he says that we are to love one another. And so Jesus is giving them a new perspective on the old theme of love. The new perspective is to love one another in the way that he loves them. Because look at what Jesus does. He's there hours before his crucifixion, Dick McKenzie. He's down washing feet. And look at who among him that walked with him was going to betray him. Judas. But Jesus still washes his feet. Jesus still goes on to give his life. Even in the midst of being betrayed, he still goes on to give his life. He still could have called down a legion of angels and ended all that. But he knew his purpose, he knew the reason, and he knew what he had to do. And he still did it knowing all that. And God gave him all things in his hands. So, to Jesus, love is the emblem or flag by which Christians are to be identified. Jesus says that people will be able to recognize that we are his disciples if we have love for what? One another. Love, Jesus says, is a trademark of all Christians. Look at the scriptures I put there for reference. And this love should not be restricted to our fellow Christians and families, but extended to our neighbors, get this, whoever we meet, we supposed to get along. Love is supposed to bring about what? Harmony. But see, we have so much things that are not harmonious going on in our society that is just, it's ridiculous. But so many say that we are Christians. Where's the love? Where's the love? As we close, our society emphasizes the importance of getting ahead, heaping praise and attention on those with the most power. What would happen if those that were in power and privilege followed Jesus Christ's example of humility? What if you saw, and Lord forgive me, you know, and my pastor standing in here, I know this will probably never happen. What if you saw President Donald Trump get down and wash somebody's feet? See, people in leadership, you know, what if you saw somebody in leadership, him got down and washed the feet of his cabinet? What if you saw a CEO of Apple get down and wash his employees' feet? What if you saw your pastor get down and wash everybody's feet in the congregation? You know, see, what would you do? How would you respond? See, our society emphasizes so much about getting ahead, you know, heaping praise and attention, you know, on basketball stars, football stars, soccer players, and hockey players, and, you know, and people in politics and all this stuff, heaping so much attention of those in power. So what would happen if those in power and privilege followed Jesus Christ's example? What would you do? How would things be different? See, and then I go on to say here is, what can we do? What can you do to show humility to others? And whatever it is, give yourself to that someone so that they can be blessed. See, something how we can bless people by showing humility. You know, we think we are so privileged, so deserving. You know, in a world, you know, it emphasizes this importance on getting ahead. But what if we see our society take a turn and start serving one another, start showing humility and really serving one another? And see, that goes into a lot of things. When we look at our society and how we don't take care of those that are less fortunate the way that we should. And we sit here and bicker and fight, you know, about money and what we should be doing with money, and we're not meeting the needs of those that are in need. See, this is another thing of being humble. Taking care of those that are less fortunate, providing to meet the needs of those that are less fortunate that can't help themselves. Those are things that we should do. So what can you do to show humility to others? And whatever it is, give of yourself that someone may be blessed. If you are fortunate, give to someone, help someone so that they can be blessed. And so as we close this morning, looking out our lesson for next Sunday, our lesson next Sunday will be abiding love, abiding love. The Bible background will be coming from John 15, verse 4 through 17. Printed text will be the same, John 15, 4 through 17. Our devotional reading will be Psalms 80, verse 7 through 19. And our aim for change will be, we will comprehend how the metaphor of the vine and the branches applies to Jesus and those who follow him, yearn for a more intimate, life-giving relationship with Jesus, and commit to keeping Christ's commandments and abiding in his love. And so abiding love will be our lesson for next Sunday. So I hope you all enjoyed this lesson this morning. I hope you got something out of this lesson this morning. Not only was the feet washing physical, but it was also symbolic in a spiritual way, that we are to humble ourselves down and to serve one another. Love our neighbors and love them by serving one another, regardless of what their background, their race, their ethnic, whatever it might be, serve one another. So God bless you. May God keep you. Now back and answer Deacon McKenzie.
I'd like to thank Reverend Connor for that wonderful lesson, loving by serving.
I pray that you take that lesson and apply it to your daily life. I pray that you come out and join us this morning as our doors will be open today to our members. Come out and hear a word from God. If you don't come out, may God bless you anyway. Have a wonderful day, and may God continue to bless each and every one of you. Thank you.
Come on.